This is the XB1, the first independently developed supersonic jet. Now, if you're like me and you're too young to have flown on a Concorde, well, good news, because supersonic travel is making a comeback. This is experimental, but Boom is building the Overture, an actual full-size commercial jetliner that you and I can fly on in just a couple of years. So in this episode, we're here at their headquarters to talk to some of their chief engineers and their test pilots to figure out exactly what goes on to build a supersonic jet for the new age. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit of Vinci. This video is brought to you by Odoo.
So this is XB1. This is our first airplane. The goal of XB1 was to prove that we could build an airplane that flies faster than the speed of sound. By test flying an airplane like this, it allowed us to kind of make some mistakes on a less expensive platform, and then learn from those mistakes and carry those forward to Overture.
While this is a story about bringing back the golden age of supersonic travel, it's more than that. We went to the moon decades ago, only to never go back. We built incredible prototypes, only for them to never see the light of day. The more I make these videos, the more I realize sometimes the absolute highest efficiency or the absolute top speed actually might not matter. What's much more important is that something is profitable. Otherwise, companies aren't going to operate it at a loss. The Boom Overture won't be as fast as the old Concorde, flying at Mach 1.7 versus the Concorde's Mach 2. It won't seat as many people, with 60 to 80 seats in an all business class configuration versus the Concorde's 100. But unlike Concorde that used afterburning engines, Overture will be more efficient and burn less fuel. And unlike the Concorde that was so complex and difficult to operate, the tickets cost a small fortune, and as a result, most flights were never fully sold out, Overture obsesses about simplicity and the ease of operation. Its tickets will be in line with business class seats on a conventional airline, meaning full flights and maximum profits for the airlines that buy them. As an engineer, this is hard for me to admit, but often optimizing for cost really is how we can have nice things in the world. It's why we use aluminum, which is almost as light and strong as titanium, but way cheaper. It's why $100 solar panels that are 22% efficient outsell 26% efficient panels that cost 5 times as much. So for everyone who loves ambitious engineering, we should all be watching Boom closely, because if they can deliver, like SpaceX, we can bring down prices and bring back the golden age of things.
How much of the challenges here will definitely carry over to Overture?
There's not a whole ton. There are a couple things. For example, the software we use to develop the aircraft, the processes we developed in designing this with a kind of a software-driven approach, all of that will carry over. Next is the external vision system. So I mentioned 12 degrees angle of attack. You can kind of take a look at this cockpit. It's not very easy to see out the front. So we solved that problem with these cameras right here. So we've got one here, and then we've got one down here. So these cameras are sent, they've got independent wiring systems to independent displays in the cockpit. And that gives us a dual redundant system for something that is pretty safety critical. Like when I'm flying this, I can't see out the front, at least not on landing. I'm really relying on the cameras.
What is the philosophy in terms of the development of Overture?
What we're learning as we're going through this process is that vertical integration is pretty key to our plan for success. And so we're leveraging that where we can. A big part of our strategy is that we're not trying to invent anything new with Overture. To the extent we can, we're taking technology that's already been certified and integrating it in different ways. And we're using very similar technology that's already been certified for aircraft.
XB1 has supersonic inlets. There will be supersonic inlets on Overture as well. They will look different. And that's one of the lessons that we learned on doing XB1. A lot of people ask, why does XB1 look different than what Overture looks like today? And really the reason there is that XB1 at one point was a 1/3 scale version of Overture. And we learned so much in building it, designing, building, and flight testing this vehicle, that it informed the design of Overture. And so if Overture looked the same as XB1 does right now, that would have suggested that we didn't learn anything in the process of building and testing this airplane. One of those big lessons was the inlet. So supersonic inlets are hard. This one was designed by us for the J85 engine, which powers XB1. So it looks a little bit different than what Symphony will need on Overture. But we actually experienced some issues with it during our initial ground test campaign.
From tracking the sun to optimizing energy supply and demand, software is at the heart of pretty much everything. It's why I have to tell you about our sponsor this week, Odoo. Odoo is the all-in-one business operations software that offers a range of applications for CRM, sales, marketing, accounting, inventory, point of sales, and even custom websites. Your first application is free for life with unlimited hosting and support included and a custom domain name for the first year. Here's my site so far, but I want to make a few changes. First, I don't like how big these cards are, so let's shrink them down and add a border radius for a nice clean look. I'm going on nearly 10 years as a YouTuber, and trust me, the hardest part is staying consistent and organized. With Odoo's project app, it's as easy as creating cards and updating progress. Invite your whole team and keep everyone in lockstep with notifications and chat. And their plans include all their apps. So if you're using QuickBooks for invoicing and Salesforce for CRM, you can save a ton of money by switching to Odoo. It's why it's the number one open source integrated business app suite. You can get started for free. And as your company and team grow, you can rest easy knowing that Odoo has all the tools you'll ever need now and in the future. Use our links in the description for the best deals possible and get started today. Huge thanks to Odoo and you. Now back to the show.
On the ground, when you're not going fast, it's kind of like sucking through a soda straw. It's just not getting the airflow that it wants. What we actually found is that just by adding a gentle radius on the lip, you can see it's kind of sharp up here,
yeah,
and it transitions to a much more generous radius. That allowed the air to kind of smoothly transition as it's being sucked in while it's static on the ground and prevent those engine stalls. We got 90% of the way there and it still wasn't enough. So then we modified the airplane and we added this auxiliary inlet that just passively opens up to enhance the airflow going to the engine. This is something that will follow on to Overture. It won't be a passive spring door, it's a little more sophisticated than that, but they'll effectively be open for takeoff and landing, and then they'll automatically close at about 5,000 feet of altitude where they're not needed anymore.
Oh, and if designing a supersonic airliner wasn't ambitious enough, Boom is even building their own custom engines.
So this is Symphony. This is what we call our propulsion system in-house. This model right here is 1/3 scale of the full-size engine, but it is representative of all of the stages of the engine. There's a single large fan with a medium bypass ratio, a 3-stage low-pressure compressor, a 6-stage high-pressure compressor, combustor section, single-stage high-pressure turbine, and a 3-stage low-pressure turbine. Added to this model, what's not shown in the model, there's also a supersonic intake. And reason for it is that there's really no such thing as a supersonic fan. It would be horribly inefficient operating in that condition. And so what that does is it slows down the air to condition it to the exact right Mach number that the fan wants to see. And then in the back, in order to transition that outward to the airplane to both satisfy to get maximum thrust and efficiency out of the design, as well as to minimize noise, that's done by the supersonic exhaust, which is not depicted in this model, that would be, here.
Is there any exotic material science that goes into designing an engine, the Symphony engines, that are different than like a conventional high-bypass commercial engine?
The cool thing about Symphony is we're using existing metallurgy tech that flies on a 787 today. We're just using a little bit more of it. So the high-temperature alloys that can survive that high combustion temperatures, we literally just use more of it, but it is the same scientific, properties, engineering properties of that material system.
What level of like thought has gone into both just the design of Overture for efficiency, and I know it sounds weird, like we're talking about supersonic travel, but I mean, I'm sure fuel burn is something that every airline's been thinking about.
Well, so the way that I like to think about it in the future is someday I think that there will be synthetic aviation fuel, which can be manufactured sustainably. Now, that already exists today in small quantities. Right. Airliners aren't using it a lot because really it's the logistics and the you need to build up the industrial base that's going to produce that material. But it does require that you need to consider that when you're designing the engine, even as simple as like the type of O-ring that we choose. We're making those decisions now so that we guarantee it will be compatible with any sustainable aviation fuel that comes out in the future.
Boom's developing their own jet engines right here in Denver. It's already well into development, with turbine wheels and compressor parts being machined just a few feet from where the team designs them. Every component from the core shaft to the turbine blades is built and tested in-house so they can iterate fast and fix issues without waiting on suppliers. By next year, they'll have their first full prototypes running, built, tested, and refined entirely under one roof. And to get a sense of the scale of this amazing machine, check this out, their Iron Bird.
We're looking at the wing. It's just a big steel wing that's bolted to the floor. But we will literally hang the flight control surfaces, the hydraulic actuators, the plumbing, the electrical, the landing gear. There's some pits over there that the landing gear can swing in and out of. So the whole point is to build all the systems on the airplane. There'll be a simulator at the front of this thing. Geppetto will be able to fly the mission and the real surfaces will really be moving back here. So we can develop mission profiles and kind of get duty cycle loading And then we can just flip it on automatic mode. Everything is gonna cycle 10,000, 100,000 times, which will be the test data that we go to the FAA someday and say we're ready to certify this thing. We've got all this data.
Take a look out the front there.
Yeah.
It's a little bit less than what you're used to. Stick, throttles, everything's kind of right where you need it to be. You can reach everything from where you're sitting. You don't have to like lean forward or anything. So I've got switches for everything I use a lot, and then circuit breakers for everything that I don't use a lot. Primary display, we were able to put the video up here, as well as all the engine parameters. And then we had the backup displays, which were off the shelf.
What's the forward visibility going to be like on Overture, you reckon?
Overture's forward visibility for the cockpits, like the natural vision, will be somewhat limited.
Yeah.
But it will be much better augmented than XB1 was. So think much, much larger displays, much higher definition. Based on the 12 landings I've done in this airplane using just this tiny little screen, I think that we can do something that has an equivalent level of safety using good cameras and good screens to replicate the natural vision that most airliners have.
Another common theme I've realized making these videos is that sometimes the real challenge isn't in the science and engineering, it's approvals or regulatory hurdles. For a long time, supersonic flights weren't allowed to fly over land, relegating Concorde routes largely from New York to London or Paris. But things are changing. Boom is also pushing the boundaries on this front. And with their no boom flight paradigm, even routes from New York to LA will be shorter.
One of the cool things about Boomless Cruise is you don't really have to tailor the aircraft to it specifically. You can achieve Boomless Cruise by having an understanding of the atmosphere. So speed of sound, as you know, is only a function of temperature, right? But then you also take into account the winds too, because that determines how quickly the shockwave's moving over the ground. So if you have an understanding of that, you can figure out how fast you can fly so that the shockwave refracts back up into the atmosphere. So that's something Overture can take advantage of, but our primary goal is to get you across the ocean at Mach 1.7.
Pilots will often have hundreds or thousands of hours on simulators where they can learn emergency procedures without fear. All aircraft have built-in redundancy and procedures for when things go wrong.
These are really comfortable.
Yeah, it's not bad. You could see yourself sitting here for 4 hours, right? Yeah.
And what makes pilots such legends is a combination of ice in their veins and a ton of practice on simulators.
United Airlines is a good example.
Yeah.
They've got this massive building full of simulators for all of the airplanes they fly. Those are level D simulators, full motion. When you're flying those things, you really feel like you're in the airplane. Like the sound, the way it moves kind of tricks your brain into feeling like you're actually flying. By the time we're delivering airplanes, we will have developed those as well, and we will likely sell those simulators to the airlines.
Seeing the XB1 in person was a dream, and being a former Navy aerospace engineer, Geppetto and I actually knew some of the same people, and we could have gone on talking for hours. And now I can't wait for the first Overture jets as they come off the line and begin their own flight testing.
So that is a quick look at Boom and this, the XB1. Now obviously it's amazing and challenging enough just to build a supersonic aircraft platform, but it's another thing to build your own engine. And obviously there's a lot of benefits from doing that. And as the engineers have mentioned, their engines will take sustainable aviation fuel from the very beginning, entirely, all up front. And we are gonna see supersonic travel possible in our lifetimes. And the coolest part is that the ticket prices are gonna be like flying business class, which hundreds of thousands of people do every year anyway. And it's not gonna be like the Concorde prices of old. So this is something that I'm looking forward to flying on myself. But what do you think? How important is it to bring back supersonic travel? Sound off in the comments below. All right, so check out this video. Until next week, I'm Rick with Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.